السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
السلام
عليكم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we continue tonight, inshallah, talking about fiqh sunnah. And tonight, inshallah, we'll talk about salat al-jama'ah, congregational prayer. Now, salat al-jama'ah is very important in Islam. And there's many things in Islam related to it. So, as you know, al-masajid built mainly for salat al-jama'ah. This is the main reason for praying, for building al-masajid. All over the place, wherever you go, Muslim countries, now, alhamdulillah, non-Muslim countries, you'll find there is masajid everywhere. And the main purpose for building all these masajid is to have Salat al-Jama'ah there. So there is a link between Salat al-Jama'ah and many things in Islam. Salat al-Jama'ah also has a link to Salat al-Jumu'ah, which is fard on every Muslim resident. Because Salat al-Jumu'ah also is one form of Salat al-Jama'ah. Salat al-Jama'ah for the daily prayers and Salat al-Jumu'ah for Friday prayers. Also Salat al-Jama'ah, it is a proof that in this area there is Muslims. When you'll find there is Salat al-Jama'ah in an area, this means there's Muslims in that area. And alhamdulillah, when the people they come, you know, to this country, when they came to this country, Jazakumullah khairan, all those brothers and sisters who established the masajid in these areas. What is the main reason for this? For these people, they can pray together and meet, and this shows them that they are part of this ummah. So I can say Salat al-Jama'ah is part of the identity of the ummah, of the Muslim ummah. And this is also the same for other religions. So previously the Christians, you know, Sunday, Saturday, people they used to go to church. But these days you'll find many churches empty during the week, or even Saturday or Sunday, you'll find only the old people, they are going. It reminds me of the masajid in the 70s, when I was younger at that time. So you'll go to the masjid, you'll find mainly 90% of the people who are in the masjid, the old people. When there is, you know, find two, three young people, it is rare to find young people. Maybe in the whole masjid you'll find three, four, five, but the majority, old people. So Salat al-Jama'ah is very, very important in Islam. Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, when he started this subject in his book Fiqh al-Sunnah, he said Salatul Jama'a Sunnah Mu'akkada. Now Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq here, he chose one of the opinions. He chose one of the opinions because there are four opinions about Salat al-Jama'ah. So Salat al-Jama'ah Sunnah Mu'akkada, confirmed Sunnah. This is the opinion of the Hanafi, or the majority of the Ahnaf, majority of the Malikiyya. So the majority of Ahnaf, the majority of Malikiyya, and some of the Shafi'iyya, their idea or their opinion that Salat al-Jama'ah Sunnah Mu'akkada. And they have their proof, their dalil on this, which we'll talk about it inshallah. Now, al-Hanabila, they are saying, no, Salat al-Jama'ah is fard ayn. Salat al-Jama'ah is fard ayn. It's a must on every Muslim. And there is another opinion of Shafi'iyya, some of them Shafi'iyya, that it is fard kifaya. What do you mean by fard kifaya? That if some of the Muslims, they do it, so that's it. So it's not obligatory for every other Muslim to do it. This is the meaning of fard al-kifaya. إذا قام به البعض سقط عن الجميع. If a group of Muslims do it, then it is fine for the other people. But there must a group of people do it. So what this means in actual terms here, that we are here in Bedford. So, and there is 100 Muslims in Bedford. So this is the idea of Shafi'iyya. If 10 of the people of Bedford did that Salat Jama'ah, then that's it. So it's not obligatory for the 90 people. This is what you mean when you hear the word Fard Kifayah. If a group of Muslims, they did it, then it becomes not obligatory for the rest of the people in that area. There is another opinion which is extreme, so extreme in this, that it is shart li sahhat salah. Shart li sahhat salah. It is a condition to make the salah valid. Which means that if you pray the salah, the fard salah, remember when we talk about Salat Jama'ah, we are talking about the fard. Because the nafil is different subject. We are talking about the fard. Imam Ibn Hazm and Dawood, which is, he's the Sheikh of Imam Ibn Hazm, and some of the Hanabila, and this chose by Ibn Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahmatullah alayh, that Salat al-Jama'ah shart li sahhat al-Salah. This means that to make the salah valid for the fard, if you have no excuse, your salah will not be accepted if you have no excuse unless you do it in jama'ah. I'll say this again. So this opinion, which is extreme as I said, that if you have no excuse, then your salah, salat al-fard, will be invalid unless you pray it in jama'ah. Now, we can discuss all these opinions, but what I like you to understand that saying it is only Sunnah Mu'akkada, as Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq said, is not the only opinion. Because when you come and read in Fiqh Sunnah and you'll find Sunnah Mu'akkada, and if you take what he said, just this is the final opinion, this, it is not the final opinion. So as I said to you, there is opinion saying, no, even Sunnah Mu'akkada, even Fard Ayn is not enough. It has to be all the salat al-fard must be in jama'ah. This is one of the opinions. Now, Sheikh Nasir al-Din al-Albani, rahmatullah alayhi, in his book, Tamam al-Minna, he discussed what Sayyid Sabiq, rahmatullah alayhi, said. So he said, قوله صلاة الجماعة سنة مؤكدة قلت. So Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq said, صلاة الجماعة سنة مؤكدة. Sheikh Nasir al-Albani saying, لقد تساهل المؤلف في هذا الحكم. So المؤلف, the author in this حكم, saying it is سنة مؤكدة, he made the thing so easy, simple. فإن معنى كونها سنة مؤكدة عند الفقهاء أنه يثاب فاعلها ولا يعاقب تاركها. Because the meaning of سنة مؤكدة in the فقهاء terms, that the one who will do it will be rewarded, the one who will not do it, he will not be punished. So that is the meaning of سنة when we talk about الفقهاء. So when this, as you know, الفرض يثاب فاعله ويعاقب تاركه. الفرض, if you do it, you'll be rewarded. If you don't do it, you'll be punished. This is الفرض. السنة, if you do it, you'll be rewarded. If you don't do it, you'll not be punished. So Sheikh Al-Albani rahmatullah alayhi saying, when Sayyid Sabiq rahmatullah alayhi said that Salat al-Jama'a Sunnah Mu'akkada, he put it under this tab that if you do it, you'll be rewarded. If you don't do it, then there is no punishment. So he said, فكيف يصح هذا في حق المتخلفين عن صلاة الجماعة وقد هم صلى الله عليه وسلم بحرق بيوتهم عليهم كما في الحديث الرابع في الكتاب. So how this can be accepted for those who don't come to صلاة الجماعة, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was intending to burn or to put in the fire the houses of those who didn't come to Salat al-Jama'ah, as this is in the fourth hadith in Fiqh al-Sunnah. Then he said, وَقَدْ قَالَ ابْنُ الْقَيِّمْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لِيَحْرِقَ مُرْتَكِبَ صَغِيرَةٍ فَتَرْكُ الصَّلَاةِ فِي الْجَمَاعَةِ هُوَ مِنَ الْكَبَائِرِ. Ibn al-Qayyim rahmahullah said, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he will not burn the one who commit saghira, minor sin. So Ibn al-Qayyim saying, neglecting or leaving salat al-jama'ah, one of the major sins. One of the major sins. بل كيف يصح هذا مع قوله في صلى الله عليه وسلم للأعمى, أجب, مع أنه فوق كونه أعمى ليس له قائد يقوده إلى المسجد كما في الحديث الثالث. So there is some hadith, we read them in a minute inshallah. So the third hadith that Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq mentioned Fiqh al-Sunnah about a blind man came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and he said, إن المدينة كثيرة الهوام والسباع, that in Medina there is many beasts and there is you know, wild animals, and I don't have someone to help me to come to the masjid. So O Prophet of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, give me a permission that not to come to the jama'ah. So Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, okay, you are permitted. Then when he went, Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said to him, asked, call back, he said, هل تسمع النداء؟ Do you listen to the adhan? He said, yes. He said, إذن فأجب. Then you must answer. So this is the hadith. Sheikh Nasir saying, rahmatullah alayh, how we can accept that this is sunnah mu'akkada? When Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم said to the blind man, أجب, answer, while he is blind, on top of that, he has no one to help him to come to the masjid, as in the hadith al-thalith. And also, in his way, there is trees and stones, according to some of the narration of the hadith. فهل هناك حكم اجتمع فيه مثل هذه القراءة المؤكدة الوجوب ومع ذلك يقال هو ليس بواجب? Is there any other ruling has all these supporting evidence which supports that it is wajib. And after all of these, Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq saying it is not wajib, it is only sunnah mu'akkada. وكذلك قوله في الحديث السادس إلا قد استحوذ عليهم الشيطان. There is hadith that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said if there is three people and they are in a place and they don't pray jama'ah together, then shaitan will be controlling them. And this hadith is another proof, as Sheikh Al-Alwan said, that this salat al-jama'ah is wajib. إذ أن من ترك سنة بل السنن كلها مع المحافظة على الواجبات لا يقال فيه استحوذ عليه الشيطان. He's saying the one who leaves sunnah or even all the sunnahs and he's still doing all the wajibat, all the obligatory, we don't say about him استحوذ عليه الشيطان, that shaitan is controlling him. كما يشير ذلك حديث العربي دخل الجنة إن صدق. Then الشيخ الألباني said ويغلب على ظني أن المؤلف حين كتب هذه المسألة كان متأثرا بما قرأه في الأوطار للشوقاني في هذا البحث. And then he said that he think that when Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq رحمة الله عليه wrote his book, he was affected by what الإمام الشوقاني wrote in نيل الأوطار. فإنه عفى الله عني وعنه قد أجاب عن أحاديث المقيد الوجوب بأجوبة تصرفها إلى الندب في زعمه. Because al-Shawkani, when he discussed the hadiths which meanings that it is wajib, he tried to explain it in a way that to say it is not wajib, it's only mandu. ولكن من يمعن النظر في تلك الأجوبة يعلم ضعفها وتكلفها. But the one who goes deeply in these proofs that al-Shawkani discussed, he will find that his proofs are weak and he's trying to adjust the things to suit what he's saying. So this is what Sheikh Al-Albani said regarding this. He explained more things, but I thought to choose this part of what he said regarding that to show you that Salat al-Jama'ah is not only Sunnah Mu'akkada, it is Fard Ayn. Now, what I'll do inshallah, I read the ahadith that Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq said in his book with the translation. Then I read after that to you inshallah about other hadiths which is, it proves that Salat al-Jama'ah is Fard Ayn. So I'll say all the hadiths inshallah in Arabic and in English. عن ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال صلاة الجماعة أفضل من صلاة الفذ ب27 درجة. So Ibn Umar رضي الله عنه narrated that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said صلاة الجماعة is better than the singular prayer when you pray in your own by 27 levels, 27 degrees. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صلاة الرجل في جماعة تضعف على صلاته في بيته وسوقه 25 ضعفا, وذلك أنه إذا توضأ فأحسن الوضوء ثم خرج إلى المسجد لا يخرجه إلا الصلاة, لم يخطو خطوة إلا رفعت له بها درجة وحط عنه بها خطيئة, فإذا صلى لم تزل ملائكة تصلي عليه ما دام في مصلاه ما لم يحدث, اللهم صل عليه, اللهم ارحمه, ولا يزال في صلاة ما انتظر الصلاة. So Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu reports that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the prayer of a man in congregation is 25 times more superior in reward to his prayer in his house or market. And this is because he makes the wudu and perfects it and goes to the masjid with the sole purpose of performing the salah. He does not take a step without being grazed a degree and having one of his sins erased. When he prays, as long as he does not lose his wudu, the angels keep on praying for him. Oh Allah, bless him. Oh Allah, have mercy on him. And he is considered in salah as long as he is waiting for the salah. And this is related by Al-Bukhari and Muslim, and it's presented in Al-Bukhari's wording. So this hadith is very important hadith, which shows us. Now when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he spoke here in this hadith, that Salat al-Jama'ah is better than 25 times of when you pray in your house or you pray in the market, he said why? Firstly, he said, when you prepare yourself by making wudu, full wudu, then you walk to the masjid. So when you walk, he said, for every step, and you see here, brothers and sisters, every step you make, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will erase you 1 degree and erase one of your sins. Then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, when you pray, when you go to the masjid, while you are waiting there for the salah, you are in salah. So, if you spend 10 minutes in the masjid waiting for the salah, you are in salah. You will have the reward of a person who is actually praying there. And when you finish the salah, the angels will pray for you, Allahumma ighfir lahu, Allahumma arham. Oh Allah, bless him. Oh Allah, have mercy on him. And we know the dua of the angels will be accepted, inshallah. And what's better that you'll find yourself sitting in the masjid and the angels saying, Allahumma ighfir lahu, Allahumma arham. Allahumma ighfir lahu, Allahumma arham. Is there any better situation the Muslim will be rather than or more than being in a masjid and the angel saying, Allahumma ighfir lahu, Allahumma arham? Then Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he put a rule here and he said, this will be for the person who are there while he is still in his wudu, and in other narration, if he doesn't harm anyone in the masjid. So this shows us, brothers and sisters, you know, how important it is to come to the masjid to pray Salat al-Jama'ah. Now the third hadith, again narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, قال أتى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رجل أعمى فقال يا رسول الله ليس لي قائد يقودني إلى المسجد. فسأل رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يرخص له فيصلي في بيته فرخص له. فلما ولى دعاه فقال له هل تسمع النداء؟ هل تسمع النداء في الصلاة؟ قال نعم. قال فأجب. So Abu Huraira also reports that a blind man said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, O Messenger of Allah, I have no guide to guide me to the masjid. He asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for permission to pray in his house, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave it to him. Then when he turned to go, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam called him and said, do you hear the call to the prayer? Do you hear the adhan? The blind man said, yes. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, they respond to it by coming to the masjid. And this is related by Muslim. So we have here a clear hadith that النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم even to the blind man he didn't give permission for leaving the salah or not performing salat al-jama'ah. الحديث الرابع وعنه رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال والذي نفسي بيده لقد هممت أن آمر بحطب فيحتطب ثم آمر رجلا فيؤم الناس ثم أخالفه إلى رجال فأحرق عليهم بيوتهم. So النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم and the hadith that narrated by Abu Huraira, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, by him in whose hand is my soul, I have considered ordering a fire to be kindled, and then ask someone to lead the people in salah, and then go to the men who did not attend the prayer and burn their houses over them. Allahu Akbar. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he noticed that there are some people, they didn't come to the salah. So what the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam here, he was intended to do, to go and kindle these houses. And even Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was going to ask someone to leave the salah. So he will leave the salah and go to these people to burn their houses because they left the salah. This reminds us, brothers and sisters, what I said at the beginning, that Salat al-Jama'ah is one of the identity or part of the identity of the Muslim Ummah. And this hadith shows us that Salat al-Jama'ah identity. You are a Muslim, you are part of this community, then to show that you are part of this community, you must be with these people when they pray jama'ah. But to keep saying, I am a Muslim, I am part of you, I support you, and then you don't come to the masjid at all, how you consider yourself you are part of this community, part of this jama'ah? The meaning of jama'ah, salat al-jama'ah, jama'ah. So the people who don't come to the jama'ah, they are not jama'ah. Simple. So this hadith shows us again that Salat al-Jama'ah is part of the identity of the Muslim Ummah. So if you'd like to check your identity, is all my identity parts is right? Check. Do you go to the Jama'ah or not? So if you don't go, this means that in your identity there is some gaps, some holes. You have to fix it sooner rather than later. الحديث الخامس وعن ابن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال من سره أن يلقى الله تعالى غدا مسلما فليحافظ على هؤلاء الصلوات حيث ينادى بهن فإن الله شرع لنبيكم صلى الله عليه وسلم سنن الهدى وإنهن من سنن الهدى ولو أنكم صليتم في بيوتكم كما يصلي هذا المتخلف في بيته لتركتم سنة نبيكم ولو تركتم سنة نبيكم لضللتم ولقد رأيتنا وما يتخلف عنها إلا منافق معلوم النفاق ولقد كان الرجل يؤتى به يهادى بين الرجلين حتى يقام في الصف وفي رواية له قال إن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم علمنا سنن الهدى الصلاة في المسجد الذي يؤذن فيه. عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه says, if anyone would like to meet Allah tomorrow as a Muslim, he should preserve in observing these five prayers whenever the call for them is made. Look at the words. If anyone would like to meet Allah tomorrow as a Muslim, he should preserve in observing these five prayers whenever the call for them is made. For Allah has chosen for your Prophet the way of right guidance, Sunan al-Huda. And the five prayers in congregation are part of this right guidance. So praying the five times in Jama'ah is part of Sunan al-Huda, as the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said. If you were to pray them in your houses, as this man who stays behind in his house, you would be leaving a sunnah of your Prophet. So when you all the time, or most of the time, you just pray at home, what you are doing? You are leaving the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you leave the sunnah of your Prophet, you would go astray. So when you leave the sunnah, what happened? You go astray. Verily, I have seen a time. Listen to this. What Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, how he described again the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the jama'ah of the Muslims at the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Listen to this description. I have seen a time when no one stayed away from them, the congregational prayers, except for the hypocrites who were well known for their hypocrisy. Now, here, many of the hypocrites, the munafiqeen at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they used to go to the masjid. Many of them. Now, who will leave it? Who those, you know, they reach their nifaq, reach an extent that even to go to the masjid, they don't like to go to the masjid. But some of them, their nifaq, say, 70%, 80%, 60%, they go. Because they are so coward, they don't want the Prophet ﷺ to know that they are munafiq. Despite that, Allah informed Muhammad ﷺ about who they are. And I mentioned this before, that Abdullah ibn Ubay, who was the leader of the munafiqeen in Medina, used to come to the masjid, and before the salah he will stand, "Oh Prophet of Allah, we love you." People make salah on the Prophet ﷺ. He's praising the Prophet ﷺ in the masjid. And the people, they know that Abdullah ibn Ubay is munafiq. So the idea here, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud saying, mainly the people, you will find them out of the masjid when it is salah time. Al munafiqeen, well-known munafiqeen, not those who are hiding themselves, they don't show that they are real munafiq, and those who has udhur, those who have excuse. He's sick, he's so old, cannot walk. But even those who cannot walk, that the end of the hadith, he is talking about them. He's saying, a man would be brought, supported by two people due to his weakness until he was placed in a room. A man would be brought, supported by two people due to his weakness until he was placed in a room, and is related by Muslim. Abu Darda reports that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if there are three men in a village or desert and salah is not established among them, then the shaitan takes mastery over them. So be with the congregation, since the wolf devours the remote stray sheep. And this is related by Abu Dawood with Hassan Chain. So just I'll go back to the previous hadith. And I seen this. Subhanallah. Here in this country, you'll find there is some people disabled. And they bring them, as the hadith said, that there is two people supporting them and come to Salatul Jumu'ah. But this shows, you know, these people, how they feel that to come to the Salah is important. And one of the brothers, he was telling me that you know, a person, I see him in the masjid, maybe every day, and he's old man, and sometimes he's walking a long distance just to come to pray Salat al-Jama'ah. And he can stay at home and pray at home. But these, alhamdulillah, there is many brothers, there is many people, they understand the importance of Salat al-Jama'ah. And even their weakness, even their illness sometimes, doesn't prevent them from Salat al-Jama'ah. Now the last hadith, which is narrated by Abu Darda, radiallahu anhu, he said, if there are three men in a village or a desert, and Salah is not established among them, then the shaitan takes mastery over them. Now, here the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam talks about a situation can be existing everywhere. In some villages here in this country, maybe you'll find maybe three, four Muslims in that village, only five Muslims, which is a small village. Not like, you know, these towns now where you'll find thousands of Muslims. Now, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam here, he understands that maybe these three people will not have masjid to pray in. So what they have to do? What they have to do?
Start their own jama'ah.
Even if they are three. Even, he said in the hadith, in the desert. So, this hadith shows us that if you are working, two, three people, do the jama'ah. Don't leave it. Because the jama'ah, the main thing is to pray jama'ah. So, might be in a play, workplace, the masjid is the most preferred place. There's no doubt about that. But here in this country, because it's not easy for all the time to come to the masjid according to the work, time of work, many things. But even if you are one, if you are more than one in that place, so could call the adhan, pray with the other brother or other brothers and establish the jama'ah. Because if not, what will happen? استحوذ عليهم الشيطان. The shaitan will be their master. They will be under the control of the shaitan. Then he said, be with the congregation. All the time be sure that you are with the jama'ah, jama'at al-muslimin. Why? In Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُ الذِّئْبُ مِنَ الْغَنَمِ الْقَاسِيَةِ. The wolf, if he comes and he finds a lot of sheep, he will not touch them. But if he finds there is one of the sheep just going away from the group, he will come and catch it, because he knows that he can manage or he can deal with one sheep. But if there is 10 sheep, he cannot find 10 sheep because they come and attack him, and he's one. And this here, in this country, we can understand the importance of this hadith. Believe me, brothers, when you will find a person, and I saw this many times, when there is a person comes here and start coming to the masjid, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect him. Because the fitan in this place, in this country, is so much. Fitna everywhere. But when you will find the people, a person, he comes here, and instead of say asking where is the masjid, he asking where is the disco. So obviously, shaitan will take him. But the person who comes here and the first question he asked, where is the masjid? And start coming to the masjid and staying with the brother. So this environment will make the shaitan away from him. Shaitan will not attack, you know, the people who are coming to the masjid regularly and praying them in the masjid, and the people reminding him about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will feel ashamed that he is praying Isha now, and after 1 hour you look, oh, he's coming out to my disciple. No, you know, even within, you know, the community in itself, you know, he will feel, no, it doesn't work, you know. I was praying 1 or 2 hours ago and now I'm in the pub. No, it doesn't work. Now, but the one, when he came here, he ignored these things and started to go to these haram places. He doesn't bother even about if there is masjid or not. Even maybe he comes in Eid or Jum'ah or something, and this doesn't affect him. He come and go without any impact on his personality. So remember this hadith, very, very important. إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُ الذِّئْبُ مِنَ الْغَنَمِ الْقَاسِيَ. When you put yourself away from Jama'at al-Muslimin, Jama'at al-Masjid, the people who are following the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, following Allah first and foremost, then inshallah the shaitan will be away from it. So wherever you go, be sure that you are with Jama'at al-Muslimin. So these are the 6 hadiths that Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq rahmatullah alayhi mentioned in his book about Fadl Salat al-Jama'ah. Now, as I said to you, I read to you other hadiths to prove that Salat al-Jama'ah is Fardai. So everyone now understand the reward of Salat al-Jama'ah, Fadl Salat al-Jama'ah. And now we'd like to see why we are going with the opinion that Salat al-Jama'ah fard ayn. Number 1. أمر الله تعالى حال الخوف بالصلاة جماعة فقال وإذا كنت فيهم فأقمت لهم الصلاة فلتقم طائفة منهم وليأخذوا أسلحتهم فإذا سجدوا فليكونوا من ورائكم ولتأتي طائفة أخرى لم يصلوا فليصلوا معك وليأخذوا حذرهم وأسلحتهم. سورة النساء آية 102. This آية, brothers, talking about صلاة الخوف. صلاة الخوف, you perform it if you are in a war. There is rules for it. There will be one, the first row will fight, the second one will pray, or the first will pray, the second will guard them. They pray one rak'ah, then they change the places. And so there is rules for it. Now, the ayah here saying, if you are among them, to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and you call for the salah, then let a group of them pray with you and take their weapons. When they go to the sujood, then let them be behind you and ask another one to come and pray with you. So the dalil here is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even in the war, while you are subject to the attack every minute, every second, he asked Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to pray jama'ah in the war, and you are afraid that you will be killed at any minute. The enemy, you know, watching. You can imagine the situation at that time, because the enemy at that time, not like that F-16, you know, send them missiles from 60 kilometers or something. No. The enemy in front of you. He, you know, watching you, watching what you are doing. And in that situation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, pray jama'ah with them, this salat, salat al-khawf. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't give permission to the Muslims in that situation to leave al-jama'ah,
what we say when Muslims they are relaxing, staying at home, watching TV or playing PlayStation, okay, or the other games now. So this is the first dalil. This dalil from where? Al-Quran. About which salah? Salat al-Khawf. So remember this. Number two. أمر الله عز وجل بالصلاة مع المصلين فقال وأقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة واركعوا مع الراكعين. فقد أمر الله عز وجل بالصلاة مع جماعة المصلين والأمر يقتضي الوجوب. So number two, Allah سبحانه وتعالى He ordered Muslims to pray with those who are praying. Allah ordered Muslims who are praying to pray with those who are praying, المصلين. He said, وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ perform the salah, آتُوا الزَّكَاةَ pay the zakah, وَارْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ and bow or make ركوع with those who are making ركوع. So, إِرْكَعُوا here, فعل أمر. إِرْكَعُوا, فعل أمر, command verb. And this command verb came here to do it with whom? With الراكعين. There's اركعوا اركعوا واسجدوا but here اركعوا مع الراكعين make your ركوع with those who are making ركوع so this means that you have to pray with the جماعة. Number three.
Sheikh, number two, is
there
an ayah number?
Or? Yeah, Surah Al-Baqarah, ayah 43. عاقب الله من لم يجب المؤذن فيصلي مع الجماعة بأن حال بينهم وبين السجود يوم القيامة فقال يوم يكشف عن ساق ويدعون إلى السجود فلا يستطيعون خاشعة أبصارهم ترهقهم ذلة وقد كانوا يدعون إلى السجود وهم سالمون. سورة القلم 42-43. So Allah سبحانه وتعالى said here that on that day, on the day of judgment, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He revealed his leg. Again, you remember what we said earlier in Asma wa Sifat. And they will be called to make sujood. They cannot make sujood. Why? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, خَاشِعَةً أَبْصَارُهُمْ Their eyes will be looking down and he will be humiliated and they used to be called to make sujood in the dunya while they are safe and sound. And there is hadith explaining this ayah عن أبي سعيد الخدري رضي الله عنه قال سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول يكشف ربنا عن ساقي فيسجد له كل مؤمن ومؤمنة ويبقى من كان يسجد في الدنيا رياء وسمعة فيذهب ليسجد فيعود ظهره طبقا واحدا. So Abu Sa'id al-Khudri رضي الله عنه narrated that I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that on the day of judgment Allah سبحانه وتعالى will unveil his leg and all the believers male or female will prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make sujood. And those who used to make sujood, make salah in this dunya for showing off and for the people will talk about them, they try to make sujood, but they cannot, and they go back with their back straight. They cannot make the sujood. And this is a punishment for those who do it in this dunya for showing off. Number four, أمر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالصلاة مع الجماعة. فعن مالك بن الحويرث رضي الله عنه قال أتيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في نفر من قومي فأقمنا عنده 20 ليلة وكان رحيما رفيقا. فلما رأى شوقنا إلى أهالينا قال: ارجعوا فكونوا فيهم وعلموهم وصلوا، فإذا حضرت الصلاة فليؤذن لكم أحدكم وليأمكم أكبركم. So مالك بن حويرث رضي الله عنه narrated that I came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with a group of my tribe, and we stayed with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam about 20 nights, and he sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so kind and merciful. And when he noticed that we missed our families, he said, go back and stay with them, teach them, pray. When the pray time is there, then let one of them to call for the adhan, and then let one of you or the oldest of you to lead you in the salah. So this hadith shows that the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered these people, they were new in Islam, when they go back to pray in jama'ah. And this amr for wujub, this order means it is wajib salat al-jama'ah. Number five is the hadith of that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going to burn the houses of those who didn't come to salat al-jama'ah. And there is a narration for the Bukhari. He said, والذي نفسي بيده لقد هممت أن أمر بحطب ليحطب ثم أمر بالصلاة فيؤذن لها ثم أمر رجلا فيؤم الناس ثم أخالف إلى رجال فأحرق عليهم بيوتهم والذي نفسي بيده لو يعلم أحدهم أنه يجد عرقا سمينا أو مرماتين حسنتين لشهد العشاء. وفي لفظ إن أثقل صلاة على المنافقين صلاة العشاء وصلاة الفجر وليعلمون ما فيهما لأتوهما ولو حبوا. ولقد هممت أن أمر بالصلاة فتقام ثم أمر رجلا فيصلي بالناس ثم انطلق معي برجال معهم حزم من حطب إلى قوم لا يشهدون الصلاة فأحرق عليهم بيوتهم بالنار. So this is another narration of what we mentioned before, that Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was going to burn the houses of those who did come to the Salah. And in this hadith, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he mentioned that these people, if they know that there is food in the masjid or there is any other benefit, they will come to Al-Isha, they come to pray Al-Isha. In another narration, he said, the most heavy Salah or hard Salah for the munafiq is Al-Isha and Al-Fajr. And if they know the great ajr in these two salahs, they will come to them if they are crawling. And the dalil number six is the hadith for that man who came to the Prophet ﷺ and asked permission, the blind man. Now number seven, بين النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن من سمع النداء فلم يأته فلا صلاة له. عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال: من سمع النداء فلم يأته فلا صلاة له إلا من عذر. وهذا يدل على أن صلاة الجماعة فرض عين. So النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said in this hadith that the one who hear the adhan, then he didn't respond to it and come to the masjid, then he has, or his salah not accepted. Sheikh bin Baz rahmatullah alayh, he said his salah is incomplete. It is accepted, but it's incomplete. Number eight, the hadith ibn Mas'ud, when he said, "Tarak salat al-jama'ah min alamat al-munafiqin min asbab al-dalal," that when he mentioned that hadith, that those people who used to leave the jama'ah or doesn't come to the jama'ah, only the munafiq. And number 9 of the proofs that Salat al-Jama'a fard ayn. تارك صلاة الجماعة متوعد بالختم على قلبه لحديث ابن عباس وابن عمر رضي الله عنهم أنهما سمع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول على أعواده لينتهين أقوام عن ودعهم الجماعات أو ليختمن الله على قلوبهم ثم ليكونن من الغافلين. So النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم he said there is some people they must stop leaving or avoid ignoring الجماعات صلاة الجماعة in other nation الجمعات the Friday prayer أو ليختمن الله على قلوبهم then الله سبحانه وتعالى will seal their hearts then after that they will be غافلين those people who if you remind them they will not respond and this threatening when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم threatening this he will not make this threat for simple thing. It must be a great thing. And number 10, استحواذ الشيطان على قوم لا تقام فيهم الجماعة, which is Sheikh Al-Albani رحمه الله عليه mentioned when he spoke or when he discussed what Sheikh Sayyid Sabiq said when he said Sunnah Mu'akkada that Shaitan will control those people if they don't pray Salat al-Jama'. And number 11, تحريم الخروج من المسجد بعد الأذان حتى يصلي صلاة الجماعة. لحديث أبي الشعثاء كنا قعودا في المسجد مع أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه فأذن المؤذن فقام رجل من المسجد يمشي فأتبعه أبو هريرة بصره حتى خرج من المسجد فقال أبو هريرة رضي الله عنه أما هذا فقد عصى أبا القاسم صلى الله عليه وسلم. So this proof again, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم or أبو هريرة here, he mentioned he saw a man leaving the masjid after the adhan. So the adhan called in the masjid. That person was in a masjid. Maybe he came late to pray. For example, someone he came late to pray dhuhr. Just 5 minutes before Asr. He finished, then the Asr called. And he left. So this just to make the things easy to understand. So Abu Huraira, he saw that man that the Adhan called and that person left the masjid. So Abu Huraira followed him to see where is he going until that man left the masjid. So maybe some people will go just to for making wudu or something like this, but that man left the masjid completely. So what Abu Huraira said, he said this man he disobeyed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the Imam an-Nawawi said this proves that leaving the masjid after the adhan without praying that salah is makruh. This is what Imam said. Unless there is udhr, he has a right excuse. Wallahu a'lam. And there is another hadith supporting this. إِذَا كُنْتُمْ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ فَنُودِيَ بِالصَّلَاةِ فَلَا يَخْرُجْ أَحَدُكُمْ حَتَّى يُصَلِّي. So if you are in the masjid, then the salah called, the adhan called, don't leave the masjid until you pray. So these proofs, we mentioned there are 11 proofs, and all of them support the idea or support the opinion that Salat al-Jama'ah is fard ayn. Now I'd like you brothers and sisters to understand there is difference between Salat al-Jama'ah and Salat in the Masjid. There are two things here. Now, and I'd like you to understand the situation in Muslim countries and non-Muslim countries. Now everything I said in this applies 100% to the Muslim countries where there is adhan, there is masjid, there is musalla, there is places to, for salah. You have no excuse. You have no excuse. If you are in Dubai or in, if you are in Tanzania or in Pakistan or Bangladesh, no excuse, because the masjid is there. You will hear the adhan. And in the at work, the people, they have musalla at work. In the shop, when you go to the market, in the market, there is masjid or there is musalla. Even when you go for a picnic outside, you will find in the way there is people made small rooms and they put musalla or masjid. Wherever you go, there is a place to make the salah and make the jama'ah. So in the Muslim countries, there is no excuse for anyone to leave salat al-jama'ah. It is fard ayn for every Muslim in these areas. In these areas, I mean, in the Muslim countries, there is adhan, there is masajid, there is musalla, everywhere. So no excuse. Now here for the people here in this country, the situation is different. Now, when there is people, they can perform the salah, then it becomes for them fard ayn. But if you are in an area and you cannot reach the masjid, because here we have to understand all these related to, or most of them related to the masjid. Some people work outside, you go to work outside, maybe 20 miles from the town. And in that area, there is no masjid. And you are the only person. Now you have the other. You have the other. You have the excuse. We are not saying that, okay, leave the work there, go back 20 miles to Bedford and come pray there and go back. It's not practical. Now those who are around the masjid, and they have to make the time to come to the masjid, to adjust their time, especially those who are self-employed, those who are working for themselves, to make it when they can make it. But what prevent most of the people of making the Salat al-Jama'ah, that the hawa, they are just following their desires. They think, if I go now, just 10 minutes, because I'm talking here about those people who are around the masjid, can come to the masjid. And they think, if I go to the salah now, 10 minutes, I lose some business now. Ya akhi, subhanAllah, if you lose some business, I mentioned this in Khutbat al-Jum'ah, that business is not yours. The one you lost is not yours, because if it is yours, you will gain it. And anyone who deals with business, I did two business in my life, and I know about this. Sometimes, many times, you'll find there is customers you didn't think about them. Maybe some weeks, if you are self-employed and you are doing some, maybe the whole week, you didn't work at all. Then you'll find the customer call you and give you a good work, worth than 2 weeks. You didn't ask for him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it easy, because this is your rizq. Your rizq will come to you. Don't misunderstand me, say, okay, I sit at home, you know, sit in the masjid all the time, then the rizq come. No. I'm saying, you work for your rizq, you advertise, you do, you'll go, but don't think if you come to the salah for 10 minutes, then you lose your rizq. This is not your rizq. Because if it is yours, it will come to you before the salah or after the salah. Or tomorrow. So what I am saying, that for the people in this country, the rule doesn't apply 100% like which is applied for the people who are in Muslim country. This apply for those who are around the masjid and they can come to the masjid. Those who if they are working in a company and if they ask, they will have it. If they don't ask, they will not have it. And this is, we were talking about this with the brothers last week, that you work in a company, if you don't ask for a place to, for a prayer, or they will not give you. Don't expect that you work for a non-Muslim boss, and when he see with you, when he see you with a beard, he say, oh, do you want me to organize the salah place for you? He will not ask for this, because he doesn't bother if you pray or not. But if you go and ask, even by the law, he cannot say no. And many of them, because they like their employees to be relaxed and do their work and these things, they say, okay, go there. And in many times, many occasions, you'll have many stories that when you ask that the people find you starting prayer, then praying, then two, three, four, then it became, you know, well known in that company, in that place, ah, there is Muslims here and they are praying. We must ask. And believe me, brothers, when you ask and your intention to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the support for that. And it will work for you very well. So this is about the rules of Salat al-Jama'ah and how we consider it fard ayn. And inshallah next week we'll talk about the other details of Salat al-Jama'ah. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. And it became very cold.
It's off now, I think.
Okay.
I have a question regarding the hadith of Abu Huraira regarding the blind man. He was, I mean, initially he was allowed, yes, you can pray at home, but then Rasulullah would be calling back and said, like, if you can hear the adhana, then you're going to have to answer the adhana. So, I mean, as you say, like, that applied to Islamic countries, but in this country, I mean, you can't hear the adhana. So if, like, okay, the brother, you know, so the means, I mean, to attend the Jama'ah's prayer, but he doesn't do that, and then you say, like, there's a hadith which say, like, if you can hear the adhana, then fair enough, you have to answer. So in this situation, I mean, what would be the
solution? My answer to this, because with the new technology now, you can know the adhan time. Because now these days, the adhan can be in your phone, can be in your wallet, in your everywhere. So you know what time, and all the masajid, they are publishing the salah time in their websites. So you know the time.
So the
because the adhan, yeah, because at that time, what the adhan means? The adhan means that this is the time for prayer. This is what the adhan means. Now, you are in a country here, and you don't. There is no adhan. Shall we say now, okay, cancel the whole thing? No. We'll say, in this situation, we go to the essence of the adhan. What is the main purpose for the adhan? The main purpose for that, to inform the people that this is salah time. Now, if I can have the salah time by other means, then the same rules apply. Wallahu ta'ala.
Okay. What about these brothers who use excuse of Ali Far, which is about a couple of miles away from the masjid and all that? But you see them around the towns and all that, you know, in their daily business and stuff. What about them? What about the situation?
I say the same thing. I say, you know, when you can attend, because far from area to area different. So, and far for a person who is on a bike is different from far of someone he has a car. Okay? Now, 2 miles is not far for someone he has a car. It is far for someone he's walking. Because if you'd like to walk 2 miles,
you need maybe half an hour. This is far. But 2 miles for someone in a car, 5 minutes, is not far. So this is how is it. The people these days, it's not only here, it is all over the Muslim world, they're ignoring the importance of Salat al-Jama'ah. And there is many things happened in the Muslim Ummah which makes Salat al-Jama'ah lose its essence. Maybe we'll talk about this in details, but just to summarize it now, when there is some masajid, you know, the whole salah will take 3-4 minutes. So they perform the salah, but they made the salah lose its meaning. And maybe the imam himself doesn't know how to read al-Fatiha. So there is no doubt, this makes the people, why shall I go? Why shall I travel 50? I'm not saying this is right, but I'm saying, you know, the two points. Why shall I travel 10 minutes to go to attend the salah for 3-4 minutes and he's, you know, reading as someone is following him? And many of them say, salamu alaykum, salamu alaykum, and leave. Because they consider that to be an imam is just something, you know, like someone he's behind the cash in Sainsbury or Asda. So just finish and go. And when the people in the masajid, they lost this social communication. So you'll find the people, they don't even try to say, Assalamu alaikum, brother, how are you? Who are you? My name is... So the people, they used, I saw this myself. You know, when there is a masjid like this, and they notice there is a new brother coming. Assalamu alaikum, how are you? Where are you from? Do you need help? I can show you where is the halal shop, where is this? We are praying this. Do you need a copy of the praying time? Make him feel that he's part of this. But when there is people coming, Assalamu alaikum, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and the people, instead of welcoming him, who is that? Where does he come from? So he feels stranger. I am talking from experience, brothers.
It's true, yeah. We have seen it.
I've been to an area, and I think maybe 2-3 weeks. You know, I go there, no one asks me, who are you, what are you doing here? And, you know, the people, they can recognize me, you know, that when I go, you know, 2-3 salahs, because my work was away. But I go there and they can see me. And the people, you know, here, you can see if someone, I notice, for example, a person, I haven't seen him before here, pray with the shah. So, well, I'm not regular here, but I can recognize there is a person he came. So, until, you know, I found myself, I have to do it now. So the people, they don't bother or don't ask, I have to do it. So, I communicated, asked the people until, you know, I'd like to feel I'm part of this community. We are human beings. We'd like to be with others. So there's many things, you know, and this thing to believe that it's only Sunnah Mu'akkada. Okay, so I'll go or don't go, doesn't matter.